Thank you very much, Giovanni, for the invitation. It's a pleasure for me to be here. I hope you can see my screen and you can hear me. So my talk is about magnetoelectric collinear antiferromagnets. My name is Denis Makarov, and I'm from Helmholtzzentrum Dresden, Rossendorf in Dresden in Germany. As you can see, we benefit from the broad range of collaborators on theory side, on experimental side, who are supporting us with the topics which I will present today. The special send goes to the team from University of Basel, the team of Patrick Malikinski, who is supporting also all these activities with beautiful NV microscopy studies. So my topic is about basically two words. It's about magnetoelectric antiferromagnets, and if you will put this into faces, there will be probably these two gentlemen coming to your mind. Antiferromagnets is linked to the name of Louis Niel, and magnetoelectric effects in antiferromagnets, weak ferromagnetism, of course, the Zalushinsky-Murie interaction. It's linked to the name of Ihor Zalushinsky, who unfortunately and sadly recently passed away. Independent of the very famous saying of Louis Niel about potential of antiferromagnets, we all know that antiferromagnets and antiferromagnetic coupling in general is very well used in spintronics, in spin orbitronics. Two success stories of spintronics are shown actually on this slide. It's hard disk drives and magnetic random access memory. Both these topics are firmly linked to the name of Stuart Parkin, who will be the next speaker in this session. And in my talk, I will primarily focus on magnetic random access memory. So this is a very subjective view on the topic of MRAM, where I will simply discuss how you read and how you write the information. So for example, if you use metallic ferromagnet to write the information using charge current, you will have standard concept of magnetic random access memory. If you will replace the metallic ferromagnet with metallic antiferromagnet, you will explore the staggered torque and spin orbit torques which is basically in the concept which is beautifully promoted by Gyro Sinova and Thomas Junwirth and many others. In this case, you will be in the concept of antiferromagnetic magnetic random access memory. Our research is very much stimulated by the work of a group of Christian Binek, who about a decade ago proposed to use electric fields to write information in the antiferromagnetic order parameter or in orientation of Niel vector in oxide antiferromagnet chromium 203 chromia. And in this case, you write information using electric fields, which suggests that it might be more energy efficient. At the same time, you use proximity or exchange coupling to the ferromagnet, which is exchange coupling bias to the antiferromagnet, to read out the information. In the concepts which I will focus in my presentation, we remove the ferromagnet. So basically, we remain with chromium oxide and interface with platinum. And in this case, we call it antiferromagnetic magnetoelectric random access memory. So that's a concept which we will focus in my talk. I will start with a topic which was emphasized by Gisela Schutz in one of the recent seminars, that one of the problems which spintronics or spin orbitronics community is facing is related to the energy budget. For example, if you will calculate for the STT MRAM how much energy you need to switch the bit of information, you will come up to the number of something like 100 femtojoule per bit, which is a fairly small number. But at the same time, considering that you have many bits and you have to address them often, this is something which really brings spintronic concepts in an unfavorable way compared to the flash memory which you use and in standard SSD drives. Therefore, this concept which Nikola and Ramesh are pushing already for some time to use BFO or basically multiferroic material or magnetoelectric materials, it has its beauty in a way that you can use and address the magnetic memory cell using standard electrodes as you do in capacitor, right? So something which is similar to a standard flash memory. And in this case, the promises which are there is to reduce the energy which you need to operate a bit of information several orders of magnitude compared to conventional STT MRAM to something like 1 of 10 attojoule per switching event in a bit. The standard concept, how it usually works, like the recent work of Ramesh group, he is shown here. So you have a lanthanum dop BFO, which is exchange coupled to the spin valve. So you always use spin valve in order to have the conventional, very robust readout as you do in MRAM. But the information is actually stored in this case in the lanthanum dop BFO. And if you will have a look on the image at the right, you will see that already existing devices can go as low in energy budget as 10 microjoule per square meter, which corresponds to 10 to, let's say, 100 autojoule per bit of information, which is already a pretty remarkable number here. I will talk in this presentation about chromium oxide. It was already beautifully presented by Nicola, so I will not repeat too much. But if you want to have magnetoelectric effect allowed in your material, you need to think about such kind of trilinear coupling term, which couples electric field and magnetic fields with a magnetoelectric tensor, right? So this puts a lot of requirements on the material properties. You need material which has time reversal and space inversion symmetries individually broken in order to support such effect. And one of the materials which is usually coming into discussion is the very first which was discovered or predicted by Igor Zaloshinsky in 1959. It's chromium oxide. And the beauty of this material is still the only one, at least to my knowledge, a collinear antiferromagnetic insulator which has magnetoelectric effect at room temperature. This material is broadly used in different industries, surprise, as a pigment due to its beautiful color, but now there is a hope that there will be also use for this material in spintronics community. So here, what is shown in this slide, it's only a couple of works which drive the development of the chromia and magnetoelectric concept in general related to current application in magnetoelectric random access memory. I think the most influential work here came from the demonstration that you can have the complete shift of the ferromagnetic hysteresis loop in electric field in such kind of a heterostructure where you have chromium oxide interface to ferromagnetic cobalt platinum multilayer, which has out of plane magnetization. The trick here and the difficulty of this concept is related to actually numbers. So if you will put up numbers about the effects which are coming up in the system, you will see that the amount of, let's say, pressure which you can exert on the water parameter with linear magnetoelectric effect is about 1 pascal. At the same time, to be able to read the antiferromagnetic order parameter using exchange bias effect into ferromagnet, you will need to have something at the level of 100 to 1000 pascal. And therefore, it's a lot of engineering at the interface to minimize the coupling between ferro and antiferromagnet in order to allow linear magnetoelectric effect to basically force the ferromagnet to switch. So it's a lot of work on the material science side. One of the ways how you can overcome it is simply remove the exchange bias, but in this case, you necessarily need to remove ferromagnet. And in this case, what you have is shown at the bottom side of this image, where you have an antiferromagnetic material, which is insulator, chromium oxide. I believe everything what I will tell about chromium oxide should work similar to for BFO. And this material will need to be interfaced with, let's say, platinum as a heavy element. And then in this material, you try to build a memory on it. The problem when you will remove cobalt is shown here. So in principle, if you will have a uniaxial antiferromagnet like chromium oxide, very specific termination as it was discussed by Nicola in her talk, and considering that it's out of plane magnetic moment at the top of the at the top surface of this material, if you will do transport measurement, it's kind of intuitive that you will read out transversal resistance or Hall effect, right? The readout is actually shown here. What you see here as it's a change of Hall resistance in a magnetic field measured at different temperatures after certain magnetoelectric cooling procedure. What you see here clearly is that there is an offset in the curves. The curves are pretty much asymmetric. And what is bad about this, that this offset and the shape of the curve is different from sample to sample. It's different, depends on the temperature, different on the cooling field, it's different. If your sample is in single or multi-domain state, it makes it very difficult to understand in transport measurement What is the state of the antiferromagnet, which you would need if you want to build a memory out of it? The problem, why is it happening, is shown here. So it's a very old problem of semiconductor community when they started to build Hall crosses. The problem is our bad ability actually to create ideal Hall crosses. If the Hall cross is a little bit distorted, then you will have the change of a distortion of equipotential electric field lines, as it's shown here, which results in a leakage of a longitudinal resistance in a transversal channel. For semiconductors, it's not as bad as for metals, because for metals, Hall effect is very small compared to longitudinal resistance change in magnetic field. And therefore, even the tiniest asymmetry really compromises the readout in the transversal resistance. So the solution to this problem is very simple. You just need to average several of such kind of configurations where you cycle contacts, as it's shown here. You basically change the voltage and current leads several times, and then you average those two contributions, which gives you a pure transversal resistance. And I'm very happy to tell that the person who is behind many of these experiments, which I will present today, Tobias Kozub, who is a beautiful scientist, now took the challenge and started his spin-off company, which is doing such kind of high precision resistance measurements for spintronics community, but also for semiconductor industry. So if you will use exactly this cyclic methods, as I introduced now, and you will do exactly the same measurement as we discussed before on exactly the same sample, at a temperature which is above the near temperature of chromium oxide, you will see such kind of red curve. The beauty of this curve is that at zero field, it goes through zero, right? As you would expect for Hall effect. Without any additional assumptions, the curve just goes automatically through zero. If you will go further with a reduction of temperature and you come closer to the bulk near temperature of the material, you will see that the slope of this curve change, still it goes through zero. And then eventually you will start acquiring an offset. This offset is now physically meaningful because it's related to this invariant magnetization, field invariant magnetization, which you can stabilize by proper magnetic cooling through the nail temperature, right? And if you will play with temperature, you can, of course, play with this offset, which you can measure in transport. And if you will plot this offset as a function of temperature, of the measurement temperature, you will see that you recover such kind of curve, which where signal from measured in the Hall effect disappears at a certain temperature, which is close to the antiferromagnetic phase transition, to antiferromagnetic to paramagnet phase transition for this material. So you can investigate in transport the criticality of this transition. You can get access to the order parameter of the antiferromagnet by measuring the surface magnetization in the Hall effect on chromium oxide material, right? So now you have a readout mechanism for such an effect, and you have a magnetoelectric material. If you have a magnetoelectric material, you can apply gate bias voltage in order to alter the change of magnetization at the surface, which will be reflected in the change of Hall effect. And this is exactly what is shown here. So you have a magnetoelectric hysteresis where the Hall effect, which you measure on a platinum, is changing with a gate bias voltage without any change of magnetic field, which is simply constant bias field, which you need for linear magnetoelectric effect. As soon as the hysteresis is opened here, then as typical for magnetic data storage, you will be able to write zeros and ones based on the difference in these two states, which you can measure, right? You can confirm that it's indeed a linear magnetoelectric effect by measuring combinations of different cooling fields, magnetic and electric cooling fields. And as you can see, the symmetry of this effect is very, very nicely resolved in such kind of measurement. So now you can build a memory, and the memory is looks like this. You have a gate voltage and you have a Hall cross at the top interface to read out the magnetic state of the insulator. So you apply the, let's say, negative gate voltage to write information, then you can store it in the antiferromagnetic order parameter of this chromium oxide, and then you can read it out. Then you can repeat it with different writing voltage, which allows you to resemble standard operation of magnetic random access memory, right? You can repeat it for many, many cycles, which is basically a memory prototype as you might want to have it. So now the question is, what is the physics of the readout which you have in this material? If you work together like cobalt, like metallic ferromagnets, and heavy metals like cobalt and platinum, you would expect that there can be physics related to proximity effect from magnetic material into platinum. Or if you work with spin orbitronics, spin hole magnetoresistance, you can tell that this can be transversal or longitudinal spin hole magnetoresistance. In order to prove it experimentally, the easiest way is just to play with a heavy metal. For example, you can take platinum, palladium, which is known to be polarizable material, and you can take tantalum, which is known to be not polarizable materials, but still the material which has large spin hole angle. So now if you will look at this very complex graph, but please take it only very qualitatively. So what you see here is a longitudinal and transversal resistance change as a function of temperature. As you can see, the good thing about it, that tantalum sample kept with tantalum has non-zero effect. This is already kind of an indication that spin hole magnetoresistance is probably much more dominant in the physics of readout process compared to proximity effect. Another hint into this you get from the that's not me. Another interesting thing you have here when you monitor the qualitative behavior of this change, where all curves, independent of tantalum, palladium, or platinum, they have such kind of positive slope here at the transition temperature. Positive slope, independent of the sign of the spin hole angle, is also in line with the SMR picture, because the resistance change in this case depends on the squared of the spin hole angle in this material. So now the current understanding of the physics of readout process in chromium oxide with heavy metal, it's a SMR picture. If you have a high quality thin film, it's still the quality of the thin film is always compromised compared to thin hole crystal. So what you see here is basically the cross-section of thin film of chromium oxide 200 nanometer thick on top of aluminum. Alumina oxide, you have 8% lattice mismatch. That means that you have definitely dislocation lines here, and you have grain boundaries. And now the question is how these structural defects affect the magnetism of this material. If you would do it for ferromagnets, you would start investigating magnetic domain pattern. For antiferromagnets, it's a little bit more involved, especially if it's an insulating antiferromagnet, because you need to access not only very tiny stray fields, if you would do a force microscopy, like magnetic force microscopy, but also you cannot apply like imaging methods based on electron detection, like for example, PIM, XMCD PIM, or XMLD PIM, which cause to use different scanning magnetometry methods. And we were very happy to collaborate here with a group of Patrick Malikinski from the University of Basel, who are expert in NV scanning magnetometry. So idea here is, following, you have a diamond tip with a nitrogen vacancy, which provides you with a thin hole spin, which you can use to scan over the surface of the sample and pick up the stray field as a function of the coordinate over the surface. And this stray field map you can build, for example, for chromium oxide, 200 nanometer thick film, chromium oxide on aluminum oxide substrate, has such kind of domain pattern, which you measure at room temperature. The red and blue contrast here comes from exactly individual antiferromagnetic domains, and this is a stray field which you pick up at the surface of about 50 nanometers. So 50 microtesla stray field you can get at this from this material at the 50 nanometers distance. What is good about nitrogen NV microscopy is that this is a quantitative technique. So basically what Nicola was quoting as a measurement of surface magnetization is the transformation or recalculation of exactly this stray field into the magnetization or aerial magnetic moment density. So this is exactly what you see here. In principle, it's basically a rescaled stray field image in units of magneton bore per square nanometer. As you can see, for room temperature, you would expect something in the range of 2.5 magneton bore per square nanometer over the surface of this material. Now the question is, you have such kind of a complex domain pattern where individual domain size is in the range of, let's say, 100 nanometer. First of all, the question is, why is it happening in uniaxial antiferromagnets that you have domain walls, so dense domain walls? because usually they are not expected to be stable. And one of the reasons and answers which we are now trying to understand for this material is related to the very specific shape and properties of magnetic or antiferromagnetic domain walls, which you can have pinned at grain boundaries in this material, where the exchange, for example, is not very well defined. So what is interesting here, but this work in progress, but I'm very happy to discuss with you on this, that you can stabilize several types of antiferromagnetic domain walls, the standard micromagnetic one, which is relatively broad, and a very narrow one, where you can have really switching between neighboring lattice sites. And in this case, exactly these narrow domain walls are pinning at their grain boundaries, which cause exactly such kind of complex to morphology of antiferromagnetic domain pattern. What is good about this investigation with NB microscopy is that you can visualize the phase transition and correlate it with a transport measurement. So what you see here, it's data taken exactly of the same sample, which we discussed before, as a function of temperature. So as you can see, for the temperature of about 302 Kelvin, the stray field profile or the contrast from the stray field is actually vanishes. This you can take as a measure for the ferromagnet to the antiferromagnet to paramagnet transition in this material. Now you can simply combine this measurement, what we did before with Hall effect, and this is what we get now by analyzing the magnetic stray field landscape. And you can see that indeed what you measure with Hall in transport is indeed the phase transition. So you really kind of confirm that you can use electrical readout in order to understand what is happening with the intrinsic properties of chromium oxide thin films. If you will have a look at this property where the magnetization disappears or the contrast disappears, 300 Kelvin is very convenient temperature for any kind of lab research, because you can use any type of Peltier element in order to play or like transform your sample into paramagnetic state or order it in an antiferromagnetic state, which is very good for lab experiments. But at the same time, this temperature is simply too low. It's just right above the room temperature for any consumer electronic applications. In this case, there are a lot of activities also in the group of Christian Binek, where the strain is usually used in order to modify the properties, the near transition temperature of chromium oxide. So in our case, we are not doping our material. We are using epitaxial strain, where thin films of chromia are grown on aluminum oxide. And then special design of deposition conditions, you can maintain the strain even which goes into the thin film of chromium oxide, which allows you to extend the transition temperature all the way to above 60, 70, or even 75 degrees C for such kind of material. What is interesting about it is that the strain is built up persistently. So even after, let's say, 1 or 1.5 years, the behavior, the electrical readout taken of the same sample right after deposition and after 1.5 years is more or less the same. So you have a reliable way now how you can really realize chromium oxide with a tunable transition temperature, which hopefully can increase its attractiveness from application point of view in consumer electronics for spintronic, spin orbitronic applications. What is interesting about the thin film is the striking difference compared to simple crystals. So in this case, I'm quoting the work of Natasha Hedrich, which was done on a high quality chromium oxide simple crystalline material. So what is good about these high quality samples is that they do not have domain walls. So it's very difficult to find a domain wall in this material unless you do very special tricks like magnetoelectric cooling of this material in the gradient fields, and you also try to put some additional pinning sites in terms of this mesa structure, as you can see here schematically shown in this sketch. So what is interesting is that if you have one domain wall in this domain wall is straight, not very wavy, as you saw in the thin film case, and if you have a mesa, then transition from the bulk, let's say, domain wall into the mesa structure changes the angle of the magnetic domain wall. So the plane of domain wall is rotating here into such kind of a S-shape type of structure. This looks pretty much as a Snell's law, of course, like analogy, and is can be understood very easily because you are these antiferromagnets have very much clean conditions for exchange or local approximation. So you have only exchange and anisotropy and magnetostatic here is very, very weak. Therefore, the boundary effects, which requires that the magnet or the main wall has to be orthogonal to the boundary, is very well pronounced here. And this is exactly what you see here. What is interesting about it, that if you will do spin lattice simulations, you will see that the twist of the magnetic domain wall is only present at the surface. If you will go down in the bulk, the domain wall requires recovers its straight shape. So it's basically a flat image. If you know this, then you can play a very interesting trick. So what is shown here, it's a position of the, with a dashed line, it's a position of the main wall in the bulk of the material. Now you can use the laser beam of the NV microscope. When you crank up a little bit of power, you can simply drag the domain wall and simply make it hang on the corner of this mesostructure. So this is something which is very, very unusual. At least for me, it was very interesting to see that antiferromagnetic wall has such a high elasticity, which allows such amazingly high deformation in the material. If you can do that, you can use a laser beam in order to basically manipulate the domain wall position. You can hang it on one corner, hang it on another corner. And in this case, you can even propose the way to write information based on exactly such kind of elastic domain wall in this material, right? What is interesting here to note, without too much explanation, that the tension energy you can represent for the domain wall deformation, you can represent very simple with a simple mechanical analogy where you have the slope of this curve, which is for mechanics would be Young's modulus, defined by the intrinsic magnetic parameters like exchange and anisotropy, as you can see here. This is a very useful analogy if you want to investigate further the mechanics of domain walls at the nanoscale. Now I see that I am very much outside the any kind of time budget. That's why this topic I will not really discuss in detail, simply as a remark, boundaries, surprisingly, are very important not only for ferromagnets, but for antiferromagnets, exactly because the magnetic stray fields or magnetostatics here is pretty much suppressed. In this case, you have a very strong deformation for the chiral G-type antiferromagnet, like BFO, for example, would be a characteristic example. You have a very large deformation of the magnetic domain wall, which has to be taken into account when you design racetrack based on such kind of antiferromagnets. The same is valid for also for skirmions, where skirmionic texture is pretty much sensitive to the thickness of this material. You need to allow substantial thickness for the antiferromagnetic slab in order to have at least somewhat close to bulk properties of the magnetic skirmion. So thank you very much for your attention.